Everyone, thanks for joining Digesting the Science, hosted by the Center for Esophageal and Gastric Cancer. We're excited to be hosting this event during April, which is Esophageal Cancer Awareness Month. My name is Sunaina, and I'm the Program and Research Coordinator for the Center. Today, I will be joined by Dr. Peter Insinger, the Director for the Center, and our guest speaker will be Dr. Kunal Jajoo, Clinical Director of Gastroenterology at Brigham and Women's Hospital. Dr. Jajoo will be leading a presentation on the prevention of esophageal cancer through screening and surveillance. The presentation will be about 45 minutes long with a 15-minute Q&A session at the end. So if you have any questions you'd like answered throughout the presentation, be sure to send them in the Q&A chat box at the bottom. For anyone who can't join us for the entire time, we'll be recording today's webinar, which will be available on Dana-Farber's YouTube channel shortly after today. Lastly, if you have any suggestions for the series, questions for me or the center, feel free to send them directly to the email address listed on the screen. And I will hand it off to Dr. Jajoo to start us off with his presentation.
Thanks so much, Sunaina. Thank you, Peter. Thanks to the center for having me. I was asked today to talk a bit about prevention of esophageal cancer and screening and surveillance. So I wanted to start with a bit of epidemiology, and these are the latest data that we have available to us from the American Cancer Society. And their estimate is that approximately 22,400 new cases of esophageal cancer will occur this year in the United States. We know that there is a strong male predominance of this disease, as high as 80%. And we believe that a significant percentage of these cases may be preventable, and that's what we wanted to talk about today. When we talk about esophageal cancer, we generally think of them, think of this disease in two cell types. We have squamous cell carcinoma, which is abbreviated ESCC, and adenocarcinoma, abbreviated EAC. Squamous cell carcinoma, in the column on the left there, is much more prevalent worldwide, constitutes about 80% of cases worldwide. And there's a much stronger association with tobacco, chewing, betel leaf chewing, smoking, human papillomavirus, and other less common risk factors. There has been named a cancer belt or a region of the world where this occurs much more commonly, spanning across northern Iran, some areas of southern Russia, and northern China. And in general, this type of cancer is falling in incidence, so becoming less common across the world. In contrast to this, esophageal adenocarcinoma is the much more prevalent cell type in the United States. This is closely related to acid reflux and Barrett's esophagus, which we'll talk about, and is unfortunately rising in incidence overall. When we think about prevention, we think about modifiable risk factors and then potentially medical prevention, and we'll move on to talk about screening and surveillance. The most common modifiable risk factors for esophageal cancer include avoidance of tobacco, avoidance of excess alcohol, and maintenance of healthy body weight to avoid obesity. We'll talk a little bit about medical prevention, which will be primarily the control of heartburn, and then a few medications that have been shown to be potentially effective, but there are some caveats with those. So specifically talking about squamous cell carcinoma, tobacco use is strongly associated with squamous cell carcinoma risk. And so we counsel patients on tobacco avoidance, smoking avoidance, chewing tobacco avoidance. Alcohol consumption is also strongly associated. There have also been reports that poor oral hygiene can increase the risk for esophageal squamous cell carcinoma. So you know, maintenance of oral hygiene with the regular dental visits is important. This is, of course, more pertinent elsewhere in the world. As well as nutritional deficiencies, specifically zinc and selenium deficiencies. Given the association with human papillomavirus and esophageal squamous carcinoma, there is a thought that now that a vaccine is, has been available for many years, this should also be considered potentially a modifiable risk factor. The data are still forthcoming specific to that. In contrast, esophageal adenocarcinoma, as I mentioned, the modifiable risk factor, if you can call it that, would be control of gastroesophageal reflux disease, to prevent Barrett's or to survey Barrett's if it is found, and to manage that. We'll talk about that specifically. Visceral abdominal obesity, meaning that central obesity in the central of the abdomen has been associated with esophageal adenocarcinoma. Tobacco use as well, and a diet with a low intake of vegetables and fruits and high intake of processed meats has also been associated, less strongly, but also been associated with esophageal adenocarcinoma. When we think about central obesity, visceral adiposity, there has actually been a quantified risk assessment of how much this can affect the risk for cancer, and that there is an increase in the risk of esophageal adenocarcinoma for each 5-point rise in the body mass index. A relatively low conferred risk of 1.5, meaning that those who have 5 points higher on their BMI are about 1.5 times more likely to be at risk for an adenocarcinoma. And it was statistically significant, but that's generally considered a low number. Just to give you some context, most statisticians would consider that a relative risk of 2 or greater is actually clinically significant. And tobacco confers a relative risk of about 2.3 for current smokers. And this is even higher when you think of squamous cell carcinoma separately from all comers, and even higher when there's both synergistic effect of tobacco and alcohol in the same patient. Alcohol alone increases the risk of squamous cell carcinoma, but has not been directly associated with increasing the risk of esophageal adenocarcinoma. We've talked a bit about modifiable risk factors, what people can do in their lifestyle to reduce the risk of both squamous cell carcinoma and adenocarcinoma. What are some medical preventions that we can do? As I mentioned earlier, the main thing is to control acid reflux, but once acid reflux has been controlled with an acid control regimen, there has also been studies that have shown a benefit for aspirin and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs in conjunction with acid control to reduce the risk of adenocarcinoma. These studies were primarily retrospective studies, and they should be taken with caution in the sense that these patients had other reasons to be on these medications. So we do not have enough data to suggest that people should be taking these medications for the sole purpose of reducing their risk of esophageal adenocarcinoma. These are patients who had other reasons to be on non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, maybe arthritis or some other inflammatory process. And when these patients were looked at compared to a cohort, they had a lower risk of cancer. This has also been found in cholesterol drugs, the group of which is called statins. And patients who were on both aspirin and a statin had a further reduction in risk of esophageal adenocarcinoma. But again, I just give that word of caution that these are retrospective studies. So we do not have prospective data, meaning we haven't taken two groups of patients, given them these two sets of either giving them the drug and not giving them the drug and compared them. These are patients who already had a reason to be on these medications and might have had a second benefit of reducing esophageal adenocarcinoma risk. So what is Barrett's esophagus, which is the major precursor of esophageal adenocarcinoma? The definition is that it's the replacement of the normal squamous epithelium of the esophagus, meaning the lining of the esophagus, has changed to look more like the stomach, which is columnar. And what I usually explain to patients is that it's a protective mechanism. The esophagus is not supposed to see acid. The stomach is supposed to see acid. And so the esophagus is making itself a little bit more like the stomach so that the acid won't injure it, won't cause it to be inflamed. But anytime you have a change in the cell type, you can then turn on cell signals that could then result in precancerous changes, such as low-grade dysplasia and high-grade dysplasia, and unfortunately can progress to cancerous changes such as esophageal adenocarcinoma. So this is a direct result of the chronic inflammation that can occur from gastroesophageal reflux disease, the body trying to protect itself, create a cell type that's a little bit more used to dealing with acid, But unfortunately, anytime there's a change in cell type, this increases this risk. So what is the risk that Barrett's can then progress to cancer? We have very good data now. Now you could argue that these are relatively older data from 2010, 2011, that shows a relatively low risk that about 0.2% of patients will progress to cancer from non-dysplastic Barrett's to advanced Barrett's such as dysplasia or cancer. And then the second study, which was actually the larger study, the 2011 study that I'm referring to here, showed a 0.12% absolute risk per year. So really, thankfully, quite low. Since esophageal adenocarcinoma tends to follow this stepwise process of inflammation, then changing to intestinal metaplasia, then potentially changing to low-grade dysplasia, high-grade dysplasia, and then potential for cancer, that allows for us to catch it early, potentially, if we're doing screening and surveillance. And we'll talk about that. Who should be screened? Who of our patients, who of you in the audience should have a screening test to look for Barrett's esophagus? We know from multiple studies that gastroesophageal reflux disease, called GERD, by itself is not an adequate indicator for screening. That's because approximately a third of patients who develop cancer might not have GERD, and an even larger number of patients of GERD will never have risk for Barrett's esophagus. And there's an overall low prevalence. There's not a large number of Barrett's esophagus from a population standpoint, and doing invasive tests is relatively high cost. So we have to balance the risk and benefit of screening. So our multiple medical societies, multiple gastrointestinal societies, and more general medical societies like the American Medical Association have recognized that there's this controversy of balancing this risk and trying to identify which patients would be more likely to benefit from screening. The overall cost benefit of screening has also not fully been identified. So in recognizing this controversy, I just put together a bit of a slide from this paper from a prior colleague, Sri Komanduri, showing the difference of the different guidelines across the world. So this is the American College of Physicians. The two with the green are our two GI societies that have put out recent guidelines that I'll discuss with you. And then the British Society of Gastroenterology and the European Society of Gastroenterology. And you'll notice the commonality here is that it's reflux plus a number of risk factors, and we'll talk about which risk factors. And each of these societies took on a different role as to how many risk factors need to be present in order to trigger us to be thinking about screening. And I just wanted to show that it's a little bit broad. There are commonalities, but there are also some differences, which might be why some of you have received different guidance over the years from your own physician about whether you should have an endoscopy or not as a screening tool for Barrett's esophagus. So these risk factors have been identified as being the most, having the heaviest weight towards adding to risk. So a family history of Barrett's esophagus or esophageal adenocarcinoma increases the odds of somebody having Barrett's on screening by an order of 12. Chronic reflux, male sex, as we talked about, is a high predisposition, smoking. And then, you know, there's a bit of a distinction between central adiposity, meaning that there's more fatty tissue in the center of the abdomen, as opposed to true obesity, which is a definition based on the body mass index. But both of these confer additional risk. So with that, we have the newest guidelines, and I won't go through all of these. I just wanted to let you know that there are guidelines from the American Society of Gastrointestinal Endoscopy within the last couple of years, from the American College of Gastroenterology 2 years ago, and the American Gastroenterology Association, the AGA, also 2 years ago. And so, you know, a lot of work being done by a number of consensus experts in order to try to standardize and codify who should be screened and who might who would benefit the most from having a screening endoscopy. So I, to make it a little easier, I focused on the one that I felt was the most pertinent, which is from the AGA, from the American Gastrointestinal Association. They say that the best practice advice, which is new on their newest guideline, is that screening with endoscopy should be considered in individuals who have at least three established risk factors for Barrett's esophagus, which are patients who are male, non-Hispanic white, age over 50, have a history of smoking, chronic gastroesophageal reflux disease, obesity, or, so distincting, if they have family history of Barrett's esophagus or esophageal adenocarcinoma, then they already fall into the category of those who should be screened, or if they have three of those other risk factors. When we do screening, we can go over this relatively quickly, and I can answer this later and if needed in the Q&A. I only included this because I've had patients ask me, how do you classify Barrett's esophagus? Why do I see numbers sometimes on reports? When we do screening with endoscopy, we look for where the stomach stops, which would be at the top of the gastric folds. In this pictorial diagram, it's at this 36 mark, which is 36 centimeters from the teeth when we have the scope in. And then we look for this lining that looks more like the stomach, which is what we call salmon pink mucosa, Barrett's mucosa, going into the esophagus, as opposed to the pale pink, which would be normal. And we measure how high it goes up circumferentially, and then how high it goes up totally. So that's when you might see in an endoscopy report. I know that many people get access to their own reports, so I just wanted to bring this up to give you some background. You might see that you were told that you have C3 Barrett's, which is circumferential for 3 centimeters around the esophagus. And in this particular example, it just mostly for pictorial purposes, they made it longer than we more commonly see. But this patient has 7 centimeters of total Barrett's up to here and 3 centimeters of circumferential Barrett's. So it would be called C3M7. And that just helps us to follow longitudinally how things have changed when we're following patients over time. And also just allows there to be a little bit more consistency across different reports. If patients go to see other providers move, at least there can be some consistency as to what the expectation is when it's being followed again. When we see Barrett's, we should be ensuring that we have the highest quality exam by taking biopsies across all four quadrants of the esophagus, because the esophagus is like a cylinder, a tube, and that we should be taking those every 2 centimeters of Barrett's in order to have the highest likelihood of catching any abnormalities. This was actually a very interesting study by one of our prior fellows who found that we might want to pay even more attention on our screen from the 2 to 5 o'clock window of our screen, because greater than 50% of visible abnormalities were actually found in that quadrant. So, you know, a lot of the things that we do in endoscopy is to increase our likelihood of detecting any problems. And while we're looking at the screen, we want to maximize maximize the efficacy of our screening and surveillance. And this study just reminded us to take a little extra time to look in the 2 to 5 o'clock window of our screen, because that might be where more than half of abnormalities are seen. And that has to do with the fact that on that side of the screen is actually more towards here, where the diaphragm is not holding down the stomach as well. I'm often asked, you know, what more can we do if an endoscopy is enough to do for screening for Barrett's esophagus? And there are a number of adjunctive measures that are now available in 2024 to help us to detect, other than just looking in that 2 to 5 o'clock window. We'll talk a little bit about wide area transepithelial sampling, which is a very specific brush that allows us to look a different way for Barrett's and dysplasia. There's something called virtual chromoendoscopy, and that's a filter that we can turn on while we're doing our endoscopy. We can actually just click a button and switch the way that the light hits the screen or hits the lining of the esophagus so that it brings out the contrast better to our eyes to be able to find abnormalities. We can put caps on the end of our scopes, and these caps might allow us to spread out the esophagus a little bit more and see things better. And then this was very fascinating because we've known for years and years that if we spend more time on looking at the colon during colonoscopy, we'll find more polyps. So analogous to that, there's actually now guidelines for upper endoscopy where we should spend at least a minute per centimeter of Barrett's examining on the way out, so that we make sure that we're not overlooking any subtle changes that might indicate that there's dysplasia or a more likelihood towards turning towards cancer is present. And so this was adopted from, extrapolated from colonoscopy data where we knew that doctors who spend more than 6 minutes are much more likely to have a higher polyp detection rate. And actually now in 2024, the guidance is to aspire towards spending 9 minutes, and you'll have a higher colonoscopy polyp detection rate. So similarly, if you spend a little more time while examining Barrett's, you're more likely to detect abnormalities. And I mentioned here, there are other things we can use. We can use a little bit of, basically it's vinegar, but 5% medical acetic acid that we can spray in through the scope at the time of the endoscopy. And that allows us to move, to try to wash away a little bit of the mucus that can sometimes be on the esophagus and let us see better and detect abnormalities. So just different ways that we can enhance the detection rate while we're doing an endoscopy. So not something necessarily that you as a patient might have to think about, but I wanted you to know about all the different ways that we try to optimize our likelihood of detecting any abnormality and being able to act upon it. I'm also often asked, what can I do other than an endoscopy? I don't want to have somebody put a scope in. I don't want to have an invasive procedure. Are there other options that can be used to screen for Barrett's esophagus? And there are now, the general category is called swallowable esophageal cell collection devices. There are a number of different companies. I only mentioned their brand names because they're the only ones who make them. And they're basically looking for markers of Barrett's esophagus that might indicate that the patient should have an invasive procedure then to confirm whether this is present or not. And so, they're really screening tools. They're not highly sensitive. They're not highly specific, but they may allow us to reduce the number of people who require an invasive procedure and detect things without an invasive procedure that that might have otherwise gone undetected. And so in this trial, the BEST 3 trial, they took patients over 50 who hadn't had an endoscopy in the past 5 years, and they either had them have an endoscopy or swallow this cytosponge, which I'll show you a picture of. And they were able to detect the signal TFF3 for Barrett's in 13% of those patients, and they eventually found 60% of those patients eventually did have Barrett's on an endoscopy. So that means that it's still over detecting, but it might allow us to exclude a large number of patients who might not need it. So it's got a good negative predictive value. If it's negative, you can feel safe. If it's positive, then you have to confirm it with an endoscopy. And these are just some pictures to give you some idea of what these look like. This is the cytosponge, and these are some of the other companies. And they're basically a capsule that somebody can swallow with a string on the end of it. And when it hits the stomach and hits the acid of the stomach, the capsule coating dissolves and a sponge opens up from inside. And then that string can be the sponge can be pulled out by the string, and as it's being pulled out of the esophagus, it's collecting the cells, which are then sent to look for this marker. So not used very much in the States. May have a increasing role now after the pandemic, since access to endoscopy is so limited, but I wanted to at least discuss the option of a non-endoscopy test for screening. And then during endoscopy, there is another adjunctive device that we can use, which is transepithelial sampling, which is basically a brush that goes through the scope. And then that brush is sent for using a number of different techniques, computer-aided diagnostic techniques, to try to look for changes in the cells that might indicate that there is dysplasia present, which is the precancerous change on that line from normal to Barrett to dysplasia to cancer. And this test may increase the yield, I would argue, to a small degree, a handful of percent, may increase the yield of being able to identify patients with dysplasia who can then potentially undergo treatment that we're going to discuss next. So we talked about the fact that Barrett's is the replacement of the normal squamous epithelium. It occurs as a result of chronic inflammation. And then this progression occurring in a stepwise fashion from no dysplasia to low grade to high grade dysplasia, which gives us an opportunity to act upon it before it becomes cancer. So what can we do to act upon it? 20, 30 years ago, the only thing you could do would to have a very significant surgery to cut the esophagus and pull the stomach up. And now we have endoscopic eradication therapies. So ablation, meaning that we can burn or freeze away the abnormal tissue and allow the body to repopulate the esophagus with normal squamous cells. We can also cut away the abnormal tissue either with mucosal resection or endoscopic submucosal dissection. And you know, the particulars aren't so important. I just wanted to give you a sense of the different things that we're able to do if we find a patient with dysplasia, which is a risk factor towards cancer, and we can remove the dysplasia to prevent cancer. So freezing it, called cryotherapy, highly effective, 87% efficacy in this original study, relatively low complication rate of 5%. Radio frequency ablation, burning it. We are burning the tissue. Here on the left is what it looked like before. On the right is after it's been burned. And I'd actually like to show you quickly a video, which I thought would give a good view. Let me just change the sharing quickly. Okay, we can just go through this quickly. But here, I'm doing an endoscopy. And here's that salmon pink. Here I'm using the filtered light to help better identify where the abnormal tissue is. And so I'm using the radio frequency ablation device. I've got my paddle against the abnormal Barrett's tissue that I already know has dysplasia in it from a prior biopsy. And I'm suctioning down to treat it, and I've hit the pedal and I've now treated that area. You can see that nice white rectangle of where I've treated it. And now I'm going to line myself up right next to it, treat adjacent to it, and burn away that tissue. And then when the patient's on acid blockers, after this tissue heals, the normal pink, pale pink mucosa will come back again. So just to give you a sense, this is all an outpatient procedure done in 20 to 30 minutes to burn away that abnormal dysplastic tissue. Just go back to the slideshow in a sec. Okay. So this is very efficacious. They did originally to prove this efficacy, they did randomized sham controlled trials, meaning that they took a group of patients and did this treatment and then took a similar number group of patients and actually faked doing this treatment. And they had a high resolution of dysplasia, greater than 85%. And actually they were able to eradicate Barrett's esophagus in 75% in the original studies. And we now have subsequent studies, much more recent studies, that show durability of this on the order of 92 to 95% for high-grade dysplasia. So they're high, both freezing and burning, and it's a bit of dealer's choice whether you do freezing or burning. They are highly effective in eliminating dysplasia, highly effective in eliminating Barrett's. They are safe, and it's interesting, the older complication rates still get quoted in all of the trials. 6 to 7% is really quite high when you look at the new trials. It's probably more in the order of 2%, but you know, out of fairness, there were higher, 6 to 7 was the stated rate. I do like to make sure I set expectations that multiple procedures are often needed. So I it's kind of like painting a wall is what, how I describe it. You go to paint a wall, you've got a
you are, you roll, no matter how meticulously you try to roll that paint on, you always, they're always hot, what painters call holidays. The next day you find the spots that you didn't touch as well. So I try to treat the whole area. You come back once it's healed, usually in 8 to 10 weeks, and then you find the little holidays and you touch it up with that paddle that I just showed you. So most people need 2 to 3 procedures to get fully treated of their Barrett's. If patients have thicker areas, then they have to resect it with what something called endoscopic mucosal resection. These can be utilized in combination with the ablative techniques I discussed. And so this is really essential. And this is why we spend so much time trying to look for abnormalities using the CAP and the acetic acid and other things that I mentioned to you, because we want to look for these nodules, because that radiofrequency ablation and even the cryoablation has a very superficial effect. It can affect only the superficial lining. But if there's a thick nodule, we have to carve that out and then treat the remainder of the flat area. So the what I mean by carving out is we might inject into the lining to create a little cushion here, and then we'll lop it off. I'll show, maybe it'll look a little easier. This is a patient of mine. You can see that salmon pink mucosa. So that shouldn't be coming up into the esophagus. So that's Barrett's esophagus. And then actually when I use the filtered light, I see that this area actually looks thicker than the rest of it. It didn't look so thick without the filtered light, but with the filtered light, I can see it quite well. It's thick here. So here I've suctioned up that thick area. I've placed a rubber band around it through my scope. And that basically allows me to create a polyp. It allows me to hold on to the lining and separate it from the muscle, because we definitely don't want to cut the muscle, and just remove that abnormal nodularity that might have been too thick for the ablation. And once I've cut it off, you see that we have a nice flat area, and we've removed that nodule right where the rubber band was with that my snare, which is like a lasso, and the having the rubber band allowed my lasso to grab it, because otherwise here, I didn't have much to grab. I could just see thickness, but I couldn't really see anything that would allow me to grab it. And this patient did very well and had complete eradication of his early cancer. Actually, that ended up when we removed that was an early cancer in that nodule. So you can use that mucosal resection for any nodules, and then use an ablative technique to get rid of the rest of the Barrett's with a very high eradication rate and safety rate. If that nodule is larger than what can fit in the rubber band, then we use something called endoscopic submucosal dissection, which was a technique pioneered in Japan. And it just allows us to take everything out in one piece. So I won't belabor the studies here, but I'll just show you what that means. These are some images from my partner and colleague, Dr. Hiro Aihara, who does this technique. And here, this is actually squamous cell cancer here. And he's used iodine to stain the esophagus to find the area that was abnormal. You see this kind of Greenland-shaped island here. He's used the tip of his cutting device to just mark all of the margins. And that's really helpful, because once you start doing that dissection, it can be very hard to see what the margins are, what the borders are of what you wanted to cut. And then he's cut all the way around it and basically filleted off the top of the lining of the esophagus and removed this early cancer without a surgery, without a hospitalization, all as an outpatient, probably in about 45 minutes to an hour, as opposed to a very large surgery that would require removal of the esophagus. So this has been shown to be very effective. Complete endoscopic resection in some studies, 97%, and a complete removal of anything cancerous, 96% in this one small study as an example. We do have to be mindful of complications. And in these earlier studies, again, the more recent studies show a lower complication rate now that their learning curve has kind of flattened, I guess is the best way to put it. But in the early studies, there was bleeding in 4 to 6%, no perforations, no tears. But when these heal, they tend to scar. So when they scar, there might be a narrowing of the esophagus. And those almost always are treatable with endoscopic techniques such as dilation or balloons. So when we talk about prevention of esophageal cancer, we've talked about modifiable risk factors, avoiding alcohol, avoiding tobacco, controlling obesity. For esophageal adenocarcinoma specifically, we talked about control of acid reflux with medication and lifestyle changes. We briefly mentioned HPV prevention, maybe with the vaccine for reducing the risk of squamous cell carcinoma. Medical prevention is primarily control of acid reflux with acid blockers. I mentioned to you some medications that have been associated with a lower risk of esophageal cancer, but that risk reduction is not great enough to warrant prescribing these medications just for that sake, but can be helpful in patients who need these medications for other reasons. We talked about screening endoscopy, sorry for the typo. We talked about treatment of precancerous findings with endoscopic eradication therapy. So I hope that that was informative and helpful. And I'm happy to answer any questions in the Q&A.
That was great, Kunal. Very informative and comprehensive. I just want to mention briefly, your microphone may have changed or something. I don't know if you can look into that. Suddenly the volume went down a little bit. But while you're maybe looking at that, I think most of the people in the audience have been touched by esophageal or gastric cancer in one way or another. And many of them have a first degree relative who has esophageal cancer, who had esophageal cancer. And based on the guidelines that you showed, did I understand that correctly? That basically, if you have a family history of esophageal cancer and heartburn, GERD, you should undergo a screening endoscopy. Is that correct?
That's correct. Sorry, I was just trying to fix the microphone. I think my AirPods died. Can you hear me okay now?
Yep.
Okay.
I think we heard you well before. It's just a little quieter for some reason. Yeah.
Yeah, the AirPod battery died while we were talking. Sorry about that. Yes, that is correct. For a first degree relative family history.
Okay. So in other words, for anybody who's listening, who has a first degree relative, so a parent, brother or sister, and if they have heartburn, they should undergo a screening endoscopy.
Correct.
Okay. And then I might be wrong about this, but I seem to remember at some point the recommendations included some sort of a trial of a proton pump inhibitor, and if you could get rid of your GERD, that somehow allowed you not to get an endoscopy. I don't see that in the guidelines that you showed. Has that changed, or was that never really part of the recommendations, that if you took a proton pump inhibitor, say, for a month and your GERD disappeared, then your risk of having a cancer or something was quite low?
No, you're remembering that correctly. And that was more for the initial diagnosis of GERD as opposed to people who meet criteria for screening. So that would be if somebody presents for the first time with reflux, and if they respond to an empiric trial, so just using a proton pump inhibitor without being sure of what the problem was, and they and they improve and are able to come off the proton pump inhibitor, then they don't necessarily need an endoscopy. But if they continue to have reflux symptoms, I mentioned to you that there were four or five different societies, they're each a little bit different, but on average, it's 5 years or more of chronic reflux. That's when you fall into the category of considering a screening endoscopy. The empiric trial of proton pump inhibitor was more in terms of for the first diagnosis of reflux and whether to try to minimize the need for an endoscopy up front.
Got it. Well, we've been getting a number of questions already. One audience member is interested. You bring up obviously this intriguing possibility of preventing Barrett's by using NSAIDs or statins. Are there any ongoing trials looking at this, randomizations to patients trying to prevent this cancer from occurring?
Yes. I don't know specifically where, but I know that there are trials ongoing for the use of NSAIDs and of statins. The hard part has been now that aspirin has been taken out of the primary prevention guidelines for a lot of the cardiology stuff, it's a little harder to utilize these medications that have risks of bleeding and risks of gastric ulcers and other things purely preventatively, because you don't want to put somebody at added risk.
Right. Again, the risk of aspirin has been shown to be significant for some patients. And just for those people who don't know what NSAIDs are, those are drugs like Advil or Naprosyn, other anti-inflammatory drugs that you can get over the counter. One of our audience members points out that although Barrett's esophagus is quite important, there you can certainly get esophageal cancer even if you don't have Barrett's. And maybe you could comment on that as well.
Yes, sure. So, we did discuss a little bit that squamous cell carcinoma is not in the line of Barrett's. Is not associated with Barrett's esophagus. That is not associated with acid reflux. So, when we think of the broad category of esophageal cancer, squamous cell carcinoma is not does not have a precursor of Barrett's. And then when we look at the patients who did not have a history of Barrett's and do have esophageal cancer, the majority of that group of patients didn't have a reason to have an endoscopy or didn't have significant reflux that they mentioned to a doctor or didn't meet criteria for screening at the time. But the overall feeling is that there still was likely acid reflux, then Barrett's, and the time that it was found, esophageal adenocarcinoma was found, but the Barrett's may not have been identified beforehand.
The other question that occurred to me while you were speaking, and I think an audience member has also come upon, I didn't know about this 2 o'clock to 5 o'clock incidence. So first of all, where is 12 o'clock or where is 2 o'clock to 5 o'clock? Where does the clock start in the human body?
Yeah, and that 2 to 5 o'clock is actually very specific to the endoscopy view. So we're talking about when we're looking on the screen and we see, we're looking down the esophagus, it's 2 to 5. So that's actually more on the patient's right side. And the reason being that when you think about the shape of the stomach, we have the fundus of the stomach, which is that top cap. And this is on the right side. So there's actually a straighter shot back up to the esophagus that way. So the postulate is that the reason that is more at risk is because it's more likely to have acid washing up there because it's a straighter shot. Mm-hmm. Whereas on the other side, there's the curve of the fundus of the stomach. And right. So there are some data that sleeping on your left side, if you have reflux, is actually better than sleeping on your right side. Because if you sleep on your left side, the acid can, with gravity, sit in that fundus and not have a straight shot to go up to the esophagus. Whereas if on the right side, it has a straighter shot. And so that's the same 2 to 5 o'clock window. The postulate, and this hasn't been proven, but the postulate is because acid is more readily able, just by pure physics, more readily able to wash up that direction.
Interesting. So I guess we should all be sleeping on our left side now.
I wonder
if they ask about that in sort of the questionnaire, you know, is that an intake question now? You know, what side do you sleep on, or what
is it? It's one of my office questions. It's one of my frequent office questions. And I do advise people, if it doesn't hurt their back or their neck or their left shoulder, to consider sleeping on their left side.
Got it. All right. Well, I you heard it here first. So, the question, I mean, you brought up the proton pump inhibitors as preventative. I mean, a lot of people are now taking over-the-counter proton pump inhibitors. And I guess one of our audience members has heard about some concerns with long-term use of them. How do you manage that? I mean, with a person who has reflux symptoms, a person who might be at risk, how do you manage the pros of the drug versus the potential risks of that?
Yeah, it's a thing I discuss often with my patients and really have to manage frequently. So we know that proton pump inhibitors reduce the risk of progression of Barrett's to dysplasia and cancer. We know that proton pump inhibitors control acid reflux symptoms. In terms of the risks of side effects or long-term side effects, there have been varying studies. Some studies have argued that there is a higher risk of a number of different things, and then other studies have refuted those. So for example, there was multiple studies that said there might be a higher risk of osteoporosis. Then there were other studies that said that that's not true. There have been studies that say there's a higher risk of dementia, and then other studies that have said that's not true. There are studies that say there's a higher risk of chronic kidney disease, but that relative risk is on the order of about 1.38, so lower than that relative risk of two that I mentioned earlier as a cutoff for being clinically relevant. I think we all agree that nobody should stay on a proton pump inhibitor who doesn't need it. And so, you know, 10 some odd years ago, when we really thought that all of these were totally safe, they were so safe that they became over the counter, I think a lot of these were renewed without really thought of thinking about taking the patient off the medication. So I think if somebody's on omeprazole for purely reflux, doesn't have Barrett's, can get control of symptoms with weight management, with dietary management, with lifestyle management, and maybe intermittent famotidine, calcium carbonate, or other things, then they shouldn't be on a proton pump inhibitor indefinitely. If a patient were placed on twice daily, just kind of reflexively placed on twice daily of these medications, I spend a good amount of time reducing them to once daily and then altering the time of that once daily. So I found that many patients end up on twice daily because they started having symptoms at night, but they took the medication in the morning. And often, if you just shift that morning dose to half an hour before dinner, you're covered through the whole symptomatic period and you don't end up having to take it twice a day. And we know, especially from the chronic kidney disease study, that those patients who are on twice a day were at a higher risk for chronic kidney disease, as opposed to those who are on once a day, as opposed to those who were not on it at all. So I try to get to the lowest effective dose for my patients. And I mean, once we're dealing with dysplasia and we're dealing with treatment of dysplasia, then I think that the risk-benefit ratio calculus changes and we're really trying to reduce the likelihood of that dysplasia recurring. And that really would argue that the proton pump inhibitor benefit outweighs the theoretical risk.
One of the things that I learned from you is the best timing for taking a proton pump inhibitor. Maybe you could share that with our audience as well.
Yeah, the pharmacodynamically, the best way to take these medications is on an empty stomach and to eat about a half hour to 45 minutes later. Because of how it gets activated, how it gets drawn into the proton pump and blocks the proton pump. And so many people, if I just spend some time teaching them how to take it that way, they can easily go back to once a day and not need to be on twice a day.
Do you ever like add to reduce the dose of a proton pump inhibitor like the omeprazole, do you ever add an H2 blocker or carafate to try to spare the amount of proton pump inhibitor you're using, or is that a strategy that doesn't work?
So it's interesting that you asked that. There were, for a long time, there was a usage of a nighttime famotidine or ranitidine or something like it in order to avoid the second dose. And then that was found to not be helpful in a few smaller studies. So we stopped doing that. And that was, those predate the newer studies that twice daily proton pump inhibitors might be more associated with side effects. So some of us have started to come back to that, but to my knowledge, that hasn't been restudied. Carafate is an interesting one. Carafate is a very old drug. And we really don't have a lot of studies as to what the benefit of adding carafate to acid blockade is. It might have some symptomatic benefit, but we don't have studies to show if it has any added benefit for Barrett's. And I know there was mention of you know, some of the studies being a little bit dated. I chose to show the original kind of landmark studies in these slides that kind of proved that ablation worked. And so that's why some of those slides are older. There are many, many newer studies, and that's why I showed the 2022 guidelines from all three societies based on what to do now and based on who to screen. But yes, the 2010 to 2012 studies were more just to show that those were the ones that where they really did the sham controlled, blinded, randomized trials to prove that these devices work.
One of our guests is interested in non-endoscopic screening. And I know, you know, in China, where the incidence is much higher, they often do these devices that you've pointed out. Is this available in the United States? Can somebody elect to do this here at the Brigham and Women's Hospital, or what's the deal with that?
It is available in the United States. Not the black sponge that was in the left column of my slide, but the kind of oddly shaped, pear-shaped one that was in the middle, I'm forgetting the brand name of it, is available in the United States. They are marketing more towards primary care physicians. I think they know that gastroenterologists are probably not going to want to say, don't do an endoscopy. So I think you can discuss with your primary care physician if that's an option. It's still...
Who has the expertise to do that? I mean, I would think that that's not... You need to be trained, I think, to
do it. Yeah, so the company comes out and trains a nursing staff in the office and provides a trained person for the first several days. If you look closely at the studies, patients don't find it so easy to swallow these things and to sit there with a string sticking out of their mouth until it can be pulled back out. But it's undoubtedly less invasive, undoubtedly cheaper. It's surprisingly not orders of magnitude cheaper as you would think it would be.
Yeah. And, you know, I think there are certain people who are at higher risk. You know, you pointed out the belt of where people are at higher risk. I mean, we have a lot of immigrants in the United States. Are people who come from those areas, does their risk remain high? Should they be under increased screening compared to the rest of us? Or
yes, there are emerging data, you know, really looking more closely at subsets of immigrant groups. So many of the prior data were just kind of broad-based population data. And there are studies showing that the risk is not much less than if they stayed in their home country, at least in that first generation. And so we should be considering esophageal screening. And the hard part about this, as you know, is that squamous cell carcinoma is harder to see. That pale pink versus salmon pink that I gave the example of for Barrett's is not the case in squamous cell. Squamous cell is very, very subtle. And a lot of American physicians are not used to seeing that on endoscopy. So you have to use the iodine staining and other things to be able to identify it better. So that I think that'll be an emerging group.
For squamous cell, are there any precancerous things that we look out for? I mean, what are we trying to catch?
So we are trying to catch dysplasia, similar to, we can't, there's no Barrett's equivalent, but there is dysplasia in both sides, squamous and adeno. And so what we're trying to catch is dysplasia, and that looks very subtly kind of a little bit granular compared to the smooth esophagus. And if you spray iodine, if the patient's not allergic to iodine, if you spray iodine on the esophagus, that granular area won't turn golden brown from the iodine. It'll stay kind of yellowy pink. And that would suggest that there's dysplasia there.
Got it. Well, we've had more and more successes with patients being cured from esophageal cancer. I guess the question is, having had esophageal cancer, what should sort of be the long-term surveillance? Are they at increased risk for getting another esophageal cancer? What would you recommend for a patient with a history of esophageal cancer for sort of long-term surveillance?
Yeah, very good question. So, you know, if they had to have an esophagectomy, removal, you know, resection and removal of the esophagus and a pull-up of the stomach, then ideally the area that had Barrett's and the cancer has all been removed, and there should be a relatively low risk there should be a relatively low risk of recurrence. But in patients who continue to have reflux or might still have some remaining Barrett's because they had a very long segment of Barrett's, those patients should continue to undergo follow-up surveillance endoscopy. And those intervals will be dictated by the, you know, what the individual case scenario was. But in general, I think if there's a long-term cure, then we should still be continuing after maybe the first short-term couple of years. We should be continuing at least every 3-year endoscopy follow-up.
For the rest of their lives.
Yes, that would be my opinion. Actually, it's to my knowledge, there's actually not a perfect guideline for right. that subset of patients.
Yeah. I mean, I think, again, I think this is a wonderful problem to have, because we're actually curing more and more patients now. And I think previously there weren't that many patients where we could actually, where we actually should be checking. So it's a wonderful problem to have. Another guest is asking about a drug that I've never heard of, and I hope that you have, called alginate. What is that?
Yeah, so the RAFT alginates. So it's usually in, or the brand name is Gaviscon Advanced.
Oh, okay.
Which is hard to obtain in America. Patients will sometimes get it from Amazon UK or other places. And so the alginates are literally just, it's a sponge essentially, or they call it a raft, where once you've swallowed the alginates, it just sits on the top of the stomach and tries to keep acid from refluxing up because it forms like a little bit of a sponge on top. They are considered safe. They are efficacious, but they dissolve very quickly. So they have an efficacy on the order of 30 to 90 minutes. Of course, they're often combined with calcium and magnesium, or calcium carbonate and magnesium. So if you have reasons that you shouldn't be on calcium for your kidneys or for your parathyroid or other things, then you have to be careful about that. Calcium can make people feel a little constipated, so you have to be a little bit careful about that as well, although the alginate might not make you feel constipated. But they are generally considered safe, efficacious for reflux symptoms. That we don't have data about whether they reduce the risk of Barrett's progression. We don't have data as to whether they actually heal Barrett's esophagitis or reflux esophagitis, but it can be a good adjunct for patients who continue to have symptoms, especially at night.
Got it. Well, we've now completed an hour, and wonderful talk, very informative, and thank you for answering all those questions for us. I've learned a lot. Really appreciate it. And if any of you would like to go through this again, this is going to be on YouTube and will be available over the next months to years. So if you ever need to get a refresher, we'll be here for you. Sunaina, you want to take us out, or just anything else?
Yeah, thanks again, Dr. Jajoo, for a wonderful presentation. And thanks so much to everyone who joined. Just keep a lookout if you want to catch up on the recording or revisit anything that we talked about today. But that's it for
thanks so much
the webinar.
For having me. Apologies.
Have a nice day, everybody. Thank you. Yeah. Bye-bye.